initial title for this was Making the World a Better, Making the World Better. And since that time, we have renegotiated the title with Steve because of his presentation. Steve gave a presentation. Steve Garside works with my office in Layton City. We've worked together for about 30 years in total. My name is Gary Crane. I'm the moderator, by the way, in this session. But he and I have worked together for about 30 years. Over that 30-year period of time, will this make me sound better? Is that... Okay, thanks. All right, thanks. So he and I worked together for 30 years. Of that 30 years, he spends about 15 of them skiing because he's an extreme skier. And every time the snow flies, I know Steve's gone. Now, I know in the last couple of years that's been a rare event, but you can count on Steve being gone on snow days. Steve has also been very active up at the legislature over those years and has been particularly instrumental in the criminal side of things up at the legislature. In fact, he's very well known in prosecution circles. And this last year, there was actually an award named after Steve by the Utah Prosecution Council called the Steve Garside Excellence Award that they will begin to award to people, to prosecutors, to a prosecutor selected every year. So I'm very proud of my association with Steve Garside. And he was gracious enough to volunteer to come and talk about ethics today. Ethics is a tough subject to talk about, especially when you're talking to three different groups, right? You've got the attorneys, you've got the, well, there's more than three different groups. You've got the attorneys, we have our elected officials, we have our realtors, and we have our developers. Now, on three of those, for three of those groups, I found ethics rules. But no matter how hard I searched, I couldn't find one for the developers. Is there one that exists for the developer? I'm kidding. It's kind of like years ago, I remember, this was about the time that Brigham Young probably was governor, but when we first began impact fees, we could not find a developers group. Today we have a developers group. Back then it was just the home builders. It was, if you can imagine, Taz Biesiger, for those of you that know Taz. And in a fiery manner, Taz represented the developers very, very well. But we did not have an actual development group. Today we do, and we're very, very grateful for that. The PRC, or Property Rights Coalition, has done a very good job of representing the developers up at the Capitol. They've also done a very good job of getting together with the cities, municipal governments, and counties to try and develop a set of rules that avoid some of what was talked about this morning by Bill when he indicated that if you don't do it, the legislature will. And so we decided that we would do it. And over the last several years, we've had that association with the development community, which has been very, very positive. So Steve's presentation today is called I Really Want to Know Who You Are. And I'll have him explain that. Because it does have an explanation. Some of you probably would not relate to it because of your age, if you're young, but anyone who's over the age of 65 will, not that, I'll have to tell you exactly how old it was, but we'll understand that. I think you'll enjoy the change of subject matter. Instead of just a global approach to ethics, Steve is going to introduce a more individualized approach to ethics, and then I'll probably try and poke something in every once in a while to make him uncomfortable, but that's about it. So with that, we'll turn the time over to Steve and let you do your thing.
All right. There were some other things he was going to embarrass me with, and I'm glad that he didn't, so thank you very much. It's great to be with you. What a collaborative effort! It's really great to see this. So, when Gary asked me to do this, when we talked about this, And you try to tailor-make these towards your crowd and realize what a diverse crowd we have. I thought, you know, I'm just going to go back to some foundational principles here. And so I thought, you know, we're going to start off with something really basic as to who we are supposed to be. And so as I was thinking about that, Roger Daltrey screamed in my head, "Who are you?" All right. And so I thought I would go with that. And so I went with that, and then as I had a chance to go beyond my superficial reactionary trying to be quick-witted self, I started thinking about the song and realized that there's some language in there that's not that appropriate anyway. And so I apologize for that. You're never supposed to start off a presentation with an apology, but I'm going to break that rule as well. And so anyway, so yeah, so I apologize for that. But going back to my 1978 naive mind, I actually thought that in Peter Townsend's vocabulary was the word heck. All right. How else would that song, without being censored in any way, make it on the radio in 1978, right? I mean, the FCC, they were bleeping the Beatles. You know, they were censoring the Eagles. And so how did Townsend's work get through there in 1978? Anyway, so that's my excuse for that one. All right, so here's a trivia question. And for those of you that have talked to me about this before, no fair. All right. Something happened in 1978 in Utah that had never happened since until last month. Happened in 1978 in Utah, has not happened since until last month. Any guesses? Those of you in Cache County are not going to want to remember this. Anybody here from Cache County? Is it that far away? Yeah, do you recall what it was?
Earthquake.
Earthquake. Close to an earthquake. It was really close to an earthquake. Weber State beat Utah State in football in New Orleans. All right. Okay, that's so. So with that track record, realizing it might not happen again in my lifetime, those of you that are younger than me, would you just please celebrate that for me, will you? Okay. Anyway, and so here's a segue from that. What we're going to talk about is foundational, who you are, and some of the things that are actually in the way from being who you are to who you want to be. So I want you to think about that, who you are, who you want to be, how close those are. And there's some things that actually get in our way from doing that, all right? And so we're going to go back to undergrad school a little bit about that. Most curricula in undergrad school required some type of a class called, before we get to that, I want to talk about some even more basic stuff. So ethos, which is the word for ethics, right? And so here's basically the definition of that. The disposition, character, fundamental values, particular to a specific person, people, corporation, culture, movement. Nothing worth shouting there. But then answer this for me. Where does this come from? Where does the disposition come from? Where does the character come from? What about the fundamental values that are specific to you, to your family, to maybe your corporate culture? Where does that come from? What is the source of that disposition, character, or fundamental value? Any thoughts on that? What is the source of that? We it's also the impetus or driving force which motivates ideals and customs. Where does that, what's the impetus for the impetus, right? Where does that come from? What is that driving force? Again, who are you? Where does that come from? And let's go ahead and jump to mores, obviously the Latin base for morals, right? Norms that are more widely observed and have greater moral significance than others. Where do they come from? And maybe we go back to that. Well, is it nurture or is it nature? Is it innate or is it something we learn as we grow? Well, so here's my thought to you. Nurture and nature come together in one exquisite point. Mom, right? Okay. And so when you think about who you are and who you want to be, I want you to throw this into that equation. Are you who you think your mom, are you who your mom thinks you are? All right? Are you heading in that direction? All right. So those are some of the things I want you to be thinking about in your mind. Where does this come from? Who am I and who should I be? So back to the undergrad question. Maybe during your curriculum, you had to take an interpersonal communications class or something along those lines. And they asked that question, who are you? And what they said was, their result was, you are who you think other people think you are. How's that for everybody's perception in their reality, right? And so that's one thing that actually gets in our way. When we're having a communication, sometimes we might think, as we're working on a relationship, we might think that, well, how does this person expect me to come across? And so we let things like that get in our way. Here's another thing that sometimes gets in our way. Men, you can listen. Women, you can just laugh at us, okay? There is an author. He's also a marriage counselor. I think he's also a pastor. His name is Mark Gungor, G-U-N-G-O-R. And maybe some of you have seen his shtick on YouTube. In his marriage counseling and in his author stuff, he's written about the difference between men's brains and women's brains, okay? Women's brains are constantly connected to everything all the time. And men compartmentalize, right? And you've seen the stories where some person is of, you know, some professional level, and then they do something really stupid when they're somewhere else because they can compartmentalize like that. He refers to it as having a box for everything. All right? It's really just YouTube. Do a search on YouTube. You'll love his presentation. And the important thing is the boxes can't touch. All right? Once you're in your work box, you're in your work box. Once you're in your play box, you're in your play box. And those two don't touch. I used to think I was pretty good at this until I was sitting in my office and I was focusing on something like that, and all of a sudden a person comes into the door and stops at the door and looked up, and it was my wife. I'm like, what? The boxes touched. Anyway, it was just kind of interesting. I tried to be good at this. He alluded to the fact that I ski every now and again. I actually show up for work, you know, when it snows. Usually by one, but I still get there. So we're skiing up at Snow Basin. If you have no Snow Basin, they've got what they call control gates. You're not supposed to go through them until they've done their avalanche control. And it had just snowed in a great storm. In fact, it was still snowing and the wind was blowing. And I said, we're gonna go to the sisters. My wife and I, we're gonna go to the sisters. She's very scared as well, if you know where the sisters are up there. Anyway, so we're like one of the first ones through that control gate. And as you go through the control gate, you have to hike up along this ridge, and then you drop down in this area that is, I mean, the first couple hundred yards are just exquisite. Anyway, and so we're climbing there, and if it wasn't freezing, I would have been salivating because we're so excited. I'm climbing up a little bit higher. She decides to stop in this spot. And I hear her yell through the wind, what are we doing here? What are we doing? What do you mean, what are we doing here? There's 18 inches of new snow. More is coming down. The wind's blowing, adding to this. This is going to be the greatest thing ever. What do you mean, what are we doing here? We have 8 kids. What are we doing here? She made the boxes touch again. So that's another thing we as men generally have to also be aware of, are who we are and who we're supposed to be. Is that core enough that regardless of what box we're in, we're still that same person? That's another thing that somewhat gets in our way. Here's another thing that gets in our way. And I want you to go on a little trip with me here, and this is probably going to be quite a stretch for your imagination. You're in one of your favorite places. It's called a development meeting, okay? And you've got all the different people in all the different professions that are working on this together. You know, you're meeting with the folks from the city, you're meeting with the property owners, you've got the developers, you got the engineers in there, and this will come as a surprise that not everybody's on the same page. All right. Have I stretched your imagination so far? This is kind of a difficult one to imagine, right? And so the stress level in the meeting is, it's okay, it's there. Now, I want you to picture in your mind a person that maybe you've had a recently difficult conversation with. Maybe it's one of those that maybe it got a little bit heated. That person is now in the room, and they look at you, and if you're the developer, they say, who came up with this plan? Of course, it was yours. Or if you're the planner, the developer says, whose idea was this regulation? And of course, it was yours. And if you're the realtor, someone turns to you and says, where in the world did you get the idea that this was worth this property or that this could go on this property? How did you react? Not how did you respond, right? Because a lot of times we can respond okay, but how did you react? So here's another thing that gets in our way, is that we're addicts, all right? Each one of us, we're an addict. We're an addict to being right, right? From the first time that we came out of a cave and started looking at things, we were evaluating things, right? Is that going to eat me or can I eat it, right? And so we still need to be right, because if we're wrong, we die. So we're addicted to being right. So what happens is that when we get challenged or we get attacked, where do we go? What's our natural reaction? We jump into our instinctive brain, right? We jump into the amygdala, the instinctive brain. And what happens there is that pretty soon our neurotransmitters are using cortisol, which I hope we've all learned isn't healthy for us. And then as we feel getting amped up a little bit, we get that adrenaline whirl. And so we're not using the executive part of our brain anymore. We're addicted to being right. Now, Judith Glosser, who we lost her about 4 years ago, anyway, was the CEO for Benchmark Communications. She's also been published in the Harvard Business Review. She talks mostly about CEOs. And I think this is applicable to us because we usually run a team. We usually run a group of folks. The CEOs are really addicted to this adrenaline flow. They're used to being right. And because of their track record, being a CEO, generally they are right. Well, a lot of times what happens is they will come in with their management team and they will have an idea and they'll get a little bit of pushback. But because they're addicted to being right, they basically force the decision onto their team. And of course they come out winners. But what does that do for team building, right? And so there's a couple of, and there's another approach or philosophy on how we're addicted to being right. And that's by Dr. Bailey, a psychologist. And I'm going to go to that in a minute. But I want to talk about this neurochemistry thing first. So this is what happens. We get into that amygdala. We get into that instinctive part of our brain, and we just want to win. Okay, and so stress creates the cortisol. When we're attacked, we have the defensive mechanisms come in, which is the adrenaline. We get into our instinctive brain, the amygdala, and we usually just talk about two responses, right? What are they? Fight and flight, right? Well, do we flee? We don't flee, right? You know, as developers, as planners, as elected officials, as attorneys, we've got a position and we've got to go forward with it, all right? So it's not fight or flight. But there's two others that aren't talked about all that much. One is freeze, and we've seen that happen, all right? Especially with our furry four-legged friends that sometimes freeze between the white lines on the asphalt. We see how well that works for them, right? Not very well at all. There's also appease, or fall in or follow. So fight or flight is how the is where the adrenaline kicks in, all right? Freeze, if we're not the CEO, sometimes, and if we presented a position that's maybe counter to them, sometimes we might freeze, or we'll pay attention to the temperature in the room and maybe we'll appease and fall in. But again, we're still in that fight or flight. Well, Judith Glauser says there's another way to approach this that also can be addictive, and it's the collaborative resolution, where we actually use the executive part of the brain. And if we use that and we reach a collaborative result, then our brain will release oxytocin. Now, we've heard about oxytocin in so many different ways, and it's one of those chemicals that gets released in a lot of situations. Most of them are involved with somebody else. It's usually a good thing. They talk about it, you know, with moms and new children, and sometimes just being, like you said, collaborative or being intimate with somebody. But oxytocin is the one that your brain will release when you have a collaborative result. You win collaboratively. And she strongly recommends that if you want to team build, then don't let the cortisol and the adrenaline get in the way. Do the collaborative approach. And I'm sure that you've all experienced that. When you come across a situation that's been so difficult because there's been so many divergent interests, but then you reach that resolution that serves everyone and how good you feel. Not just getting that off your table, finally, getting this finally done, but actually doing so in a beneficial way. The other one is, again, Dr. Bailey, and she talks about the word addicted to being right, and that's by our experiences. It's called experiential preference perspective, right? We'll just call it based on our experiences. So again, another question for you. How many of you would have any type of trepidation on walking down a dark alley late at night that was filled with graffiti? How many would have a little bit of trepidation about doing that? Okay, there's some brave folks in here. Not very many, very many. Okay, I'll go with you then, all right? All right, then let me ask you this way. How many people have actually been mugged in an alley late at night that was graffiti laden? You have been? You want to come tell us about it? Okay, you just don't go with you?
Just don't go to
office. Don't go to... I don't know if we need to go that far, right? Okay, so think about that. One of everybody here has actually been mugged in a dark alley that had graffiti in it late at night, yet we have trepidation to do so. How come? Why? I mean, Mason could just be making it up, right? Besides that, it happened in Honduras, right? Okay. So we have experiences, again, we evaluate things all the time, but do they get in our way? Okay, I won't tell that story or that story, so we'll get right to how things get in our way. So sometimes we'll have that experience with a person. All right, have you ever had a situation where maybe you ran into somebody and they were, and you didn't know this, but they were having a bad day? I come back to the office and I say, geez, Gary, have you ever worked with Wolf before, you know? Guy was a tear. He just ripped me up one side down the other. I don't know. I see him again. You go, well, really? Maybe you didn't see him as a soccer ref when I did. Anyway. And so we could have those experiences, and because of that experience, we've locked that into our heads. Right? Kirk Weisler says it this way. He explained the story this way. He says, let's say you've got somebody at work that is one of those that whenever someone tells a story, they've got a story like it that's maybe even a little bit better, right? They really like to play the one-upmanship game. And the conversation always turns back to them and their experiences, right? Maybe a little bit of narcissism. So you start talking, man, every time I go talk to Steve, seriously, man, I tell him I go on this great adventure, and of course, he has to have one better, man. It is always all about him. And so the word gets back to Steve. And Steve says, you know what? I need to bite my tongue and do a little bit better. So on Steve's birthday, he decides to bring treats in for the whole office. He's just going to try to make amends and turn things around, right? What does Gary say? See what a narcissist? He didn't want anybody to forget his birthday. Right? We say something and so we see something because we have to be right. Let me give you another story. Okay? All right, Mom, you're there and your cute little 8-9-year-old daughter is there and she's got a couple of apples with her. And you say, can I have one of those? And she looks at you. She takes a bite of one and thinks about it for a minute. Takes a bite of the second one. Same for a minute. And you're about to give her a lesson in life, right? And about the time you're saying, okay, where do I start? The little girl says, here's the sweeter one, right? What was the story that was going on in your head before she said that, right? See, one of the things that gets in our mind about that, who are we? And while I'm thinking about this, let's say maybe you have a relationship that you've damaged. How do you restore that? You make a promise and you keep the promise. Then you make another promise and you keep the promise. You make a commitment and you keep that commitment. You make a representation and you make sure that it's a true representative. One step at a time, you rebuild that relationship. Then, how about giving the other person that same grace? So I want you to go back to that meeting that we were talking about, and that person that came in and basically hit you between the eyes with your project, your regulation, your property. Trade places with them. How do they see you, and how do you see them now? Now, we think that we do pretty good at that, right? Maybe you were in the public sector for a while, and now you're in the private sector, or vice versa. Maybe you were a local official, elected local official, and now you're a state official. And so having had those experiences, we think that we understand them, right? We walked a mile in their shoes, right? But I would submit to you that fades a little bit, just like our memories fade a little bit. And let me give you a really simple little illustration. And this is, again, we're going to really stretch your imagination here. How many of you drive? Okay, all right. Now here's an even more difficult situation. How many of you have ever been a pedestrian? Okay. How many of you have ever done those activities at night? Now, tell me if this isn't true. You're walking down the street late at night, and here comes a car with you, and they got their brights on, and you can't see a thing, and you're going, oh, I wish that guy would turn the brights off. I can't believe he doesn't think he can see me. All right? Now, jump by the wheel of your car. You're driving down the street. There's nobody there. You got your bright lights on. All of a sudden, about 100 feet from you, you finally see a pedestrian, and you say, what an idiot. Why don't they wear some lighter clothes and get over further away to the edge of the road, right? Have you ever done that without realizing it from the other side? So now when you walk at night and you see a car coming, get away from the road, right? Think, man, I'm not wearing light clothes. Or as a driver, pay a little bit more attention to pedestrians, but we don't do that unless we're reminded. And so we need to keep that in mind as to who we are. So we are influenced by our experiences, and we can't get trapped in those. All right. I don't have enough time to go through this one. I'll just do it really quick. Go ahead. Again, I'm going to break another rule. I'm supposed to have you read a slide. I'm going to have you read a slide. Not bad, huh? What if I told you that the author was one of the three members of the Axis? It's Hitler, Mussolini, or Hirohito. Change your view of it? One guy showed that to me. He says, hey, Even a broken clock's right twice a day, right?
Okay.
Does the source matter? Does the source matter? The reason we worry about the source is because we're concerned about the motivation of the speaker, correct? Okay. So do you suspect someone is concerned about your motivation? You give someone credit for their motivation. Who are you? Who do you want to be? Who do you want them to be? All right, so here's a quick slide. I just want you to, your initial reaction when you see these. What is your relationship with others? So it kind of reminds me of this story, going back to the heated conversations. I was outside of Gary used to let me practice law a little bit. I'm standing outside of a courtroom with a group of officers. I think there were three or four of them, and they were visiting about something. We were just waiting for a hearing to start. And the senior officer says, "You know, I like Miranda." We were talking about it. At the time, there were some discussions about, did we think the Supreme Court was going to modify Miranda a little bit, or what was going on. He says, "I like Miranda." And the rest of us stopped to listen to him. And I says, "Tell me, why do you like Miranda?" He says, "Because Miranda, when I give the Miranda warning, it puts me back. It reminds me who I am." He says, "I've been in the middle of some ugly, ugly situations where some people that I'm getting ready to interrogate have done some absolutely horrific things to some individuals, and I would just as soon rip their face off than do the investigation. And then I read a Miranda, and it reminds me of who I am. It reminds me of my role. It reminds me to be a professional. It reminds me that regardless of what this person does, has done, they're a human being. They're protected by the Constitution. No different than if I were on the other side of the table, I would want those same protections. I like Miranda." So I was thinking about that, thinking, he just said, regardless of the case, it helps him remind him who he is. And so think about that. Is there something in your life, is there something that you can do to help you remember who you are? Who you want to be, who your mom thinks you are. Okay? So I was messing with that. I don't know if I did a very good job of it, but so next time you go into a meeting, tell yourself this: you have the right to remain silent, but you won't. Any tone, volume, negatively perceived language will be held against you throughout this project and future projects. You have the right to counsel, so counsel with yourself. If you can't afford that, bring a friend who's willing to kick you underneath the table. Okay? So what is your Miranda to maintain your professionalism? I'm reading a book right now called Crucial Conversation, and it's got four authors, and it's pretty good. It talks a little bit about this, how sometimes we'll get in these heated meetings, and again, we want to win, and because we're attacked, or because we want to win, we forget the objective. What is the objective of the meeting? We get distracted from that. And so we have to step back and say, okay, what are the facts? Now, the facts are there's a little girl with two apples and she's bitten each of them. That's the facts. There's no reason to start a story till I know her story. So I'm in a meeting. What's our commonality? What's our common ground? Everybody in that meeting wants a good development. There's the common ground. And everybody's definition of good is significantly different, right? Okay. But that's the common ground. We want the good objective, the good development. Here's another tool that we can use as we're meeting with those with which we may have a difference of opinion. This is habit number 5 from Stephen Covey. Seek to understand, then to be understood. I'm confident that we've had situations where we've probably, the amygdala has kicked in, we're using the instinctive instead of the executive brain, and we know we're right, right? And we're addicted to being right, but we also know that we're right. And that sometimes can get in the way of the message as well as the result. In this book, in the Crucial Conversation, you talk about a bunch of different situations. One is where a mother and a father have had a teenage son who violated some rules, so they're going to ground him. They're going to absolutely ground him. But there was some activity that he was going to go to, and the parents had not communicated on when the grounding was going to start. Anyway, so he goes off to the activity, and man, big fight between mom and dad, right? Their goal, their commonality was exactly the same. The kid was going to be grounded. They just hadn't decided when. So seek to understand, then to be understood. A situation I had, again, when Gary would let me play in court, there was a couple of defense attorneys that, man, just could not get a reasonable resolution with these guys, at least not for the first 3, 4, 6, 7 pretrials, okay? But they would, it was always, you know, you cops screwed up, I can't believe you approved these charges. It was always the attack, the attack, the attack. And I was thinking, okay, I gotta break this routine. And so my response then became, you know what? I've never seen a perfect case. What have you got? Let's talk about it. And then just let them unload. Kind of funny, because then I say, oh, it's like your client screwed up, not my cops, right? So what is your opening? How are you gonna get past that? Next week you're gonna be meeting with a developer, a planner, a builder, a realtor. You've had a difficult situation in the past. How are you gonna open that conversation? Are you gonna be prepared? Who are you? Who do you want them to see you as? An opponent or a collaborative individual? You gonna go with the adrenaline or you gonna go with the oxytocin? So seek to understand and then be understood. So look back in your history, whether it's been a long one or a short one. Are you a better realtor, builder, attorney, planner, developer, public servant than you were last year? 3 years ago? How many of you feel that you're better than you were a couple, 3 years ago? Okay? Hopefully everybody is, right? And why? Why would we be better than we were a few years ago? We learn from mistakes, right? We've had some experiences that we've gone. We've come to trainings like this where we've put ourselves in a position to learn better and be better. Are you a better office mate or colleague? Are you a better friend? Are you a better parent? Are you a better child than you were 3 years ago? often said that when we say things like, I don't have time for that, replace the word time with priority. Right? I don't have time to exercise. Well, exercise obviously isn't a priority then. I don't have time to eat right. Well, then eating right is not a priority. Who are you and who do you want to be? Back to having those difficult conversations. Abraham Lincoln, I don't know if any of you, maybe I'm sure probably a lot of you have heard this. Abraham Lincoln's quote was, I do not like that man very much. I must get to know him better. Seek to understand and be understood. Of course, I probably shouldn't even say this since we're supposed to be talking about ethics, but anyway, I will. So I did my graduate work in Oklahoma, and just kind of interesting because the main airport there in Oklahoma City is called Will Rogers International Airport. Airport number two is called Wiley Post Airport, okay? Anybody know the relationship between those two? Wiley Post was Will Rogers' pilot, and he died in a plane crash. So, of course, you name an airport after him, right? Anyway, so Will Rogers was always famous for saying, I never met a man I didn't like. And so probably the number one ethical put down in Oklahoma was you'd have a disagreement with someone, and you would say to them, Will Rogers never met you, did he? Anyway, so again, are you prepared for having that difficult conversation? So be prepared for those and be ready to diffuse for those, okay? Again, being able to look at the situations from somebody else's perspective, but be reminded of the rudimentary things that maybe you have forgotten about being in that position. I guess one of the key things that we need to think about is the who we are. Again, it's back to being right and being locked into our experience. And so then we see things preferentially. I think an example of that is maybe you've had this experience where you're either wanting a new car or you just purchased a new car, and then all of a sudden you realize how many more of those same vehicles are out on the road, right? Okay. Again, that's something that our mind messes with, and so we need to be mindful of those things as we go into those conversations. Anyway, so as we think about who we are, and you know, Gary talked about the title of this was Making the World Better, and maybe thought it was a little aspirational, and it probably is, but again, if we want the world better, where do we start? Right here with us, how reactionary we are. What stories are we telling ourselves? What stories are we using to interpret what actually is going on in front of us at the time? Okay. And so I've got an invitation for you. Be cognizant of how you react. So when you're in a difficult situation, how do you react? Just be aware of that. How am I responding? Am I in the executive brain or have I dropped into the instinctive brain? Okay. Seek oxytocin over adrenaline. It's more healthy for you. All right. Not that you want to avoid adrenaline. I mean, it's appropriate. It's fun. Frame your frame of mind, okay? How open-minded am I? Am I gonna give this person the same grace that I want them to give me as I'm trying to rebuild or build this relationship? And maybe I've stubbed my toe in the past. Create your Miranda centering. What is it that you can do to woodshed yourself to make sure that you're gonna maintain as you go into this difficult conversation? And then continue to be a better you. So, one last question. It didn't click. You want to hit the speaker in the bottom left for me? There's that little icon in the bottom left. So you can tell he wasn't a child from the 70s because he would have turned it up instead of turning it down. So, but it's another example, again, of my experience preference, because indeed, as I look back on that, I really did think that we didn't play that part of the song, I really thought that the word he said was heck, because my experience had been the FCC had bleeped out all the other profanities and came across, not that there was very much profanity in rock and roll songs, but anyway, I bleeped it out. But anyway, so remember, ask yourself who you are, and then, okay, one more last question. Who are you from your mom's perspective? All right. Anything you wanted to add to that, Mr. Crane?
No, I appreciate the thoughts that Steve's presented to you, and it's interesting because I wanted him to present this from an individual basis, because really that's where it all starts, is on an individual basis for each one of us. It was interesting as he went through the names, and as I look out over the faces, I have a concept of who you are. And this morning as I was identifying to one of my associates, this person over here is the mayor of Mill Creek. He's a fantastic guy. He just does things awesomely. And there's a planner over there from Davis County who does a great job. And it's interesting how we do that, how we build that over a period of time. We build those relationships. I had a developer call me the other day, a developer's attorney call me the other day. And he's one who's been in practice for years and years. And he knew enough to ask me this. He said, Gary, he said, who is the best developer that you had in Layton City? And if it was a 10, who would that be? Without a doubt, I know exactly who he is. I'll tell you, I told him his name, and he goes, oh yeah, I represented him. He is fantastic. He's excellent. And he says, what do I do to get my developer into the 10 position? Because where's my developer now, Gary? And I said, well, he's way down there, 4, 3, 2, maybe one after what he did last week. And so the question was, how do you change that? How do you make a difference? How do you change the opinion, your opinion, about somebody else? And it all comes down to some of the things that Steve talked about. For example, not breaking promises, keeping those promises that you make, being reliable. You don't come in with a different story every single time. You don't try and hide things. The same developer, we started out like this. We had a project that we put together, and in that project, there was a road that the city and the county would share. And he knew that the city and the county were going to share responsibility for that road. He also knew that on the other side of the road, there was a great big set of high-tension power lines and poles that had to be moved at a cost of about $150,000. And left those off the plans as they went all the way through the process, and then wanted to convey that property to the city with the responsibility to build, unbeknownst to us, to actually relocate those poles. I mean, that's the kind of thing that took him from if he was a 10 to start with, I'll give him credit there, all the way down to 1. Now, I've also known city representatives who have done the same thing, who standing in a meeting end up in changing your subdivision laws by a suggestion. There's one particular council person in one particular situation that knew that there was a developer who was over a barrel because of access
that they were not able to obtain from UDOT on that road. And so in order to get that approved without that particular access, that person wanted the developer now to build a park. You build a park, where in the ordinance does it say I need to build? Well, no. If you want your subdivision approved, you're going to build a park. And the interesting thing about it was that the other council people went along with her. Or him, I can't remember. Otherwise, some of you might be able to identify who that was. Sorry. But the bottom line is, if he or she started as a 10, they quickly dropped, right, to a 1 or a 2. And it is all because of individual decisions. Now, we get dragged along by the crowd. There's no question that there's a group thing that happens. The Wisdom of Crowds is a really good book if you ever have the chance to read it. How we make the wrong decisions sometimes because of the fact that we all kind of congregate together and make the same decision. One person recommends the bad decision, the next person reinforces it, and then everybody votes for it. And before you know, the wrong decision has been made. So it happens on both sides of the ledger. It really does. But the bottom line is these decisions are individual. They start with individuals. And they are made by individuals, ultimately. I've seen attorneys, you're not going to get away with it, lawyers. Us, me. I've seen lawyers that have to please the legislative body that they've been hired to represent. I saw one night in a public hearing, I saw them grill their attorney over a specific issue, and that attorney continued to hold fast, and the next thing, after the meeting was over, the attorney, the discussion was, how do we replace this attorney? Because we don't like the decision that he just gave us. That attorney, to me, had more credibility than any member of the council did because of the fact that he held to that. I've also seen lawyers that will twist the law. Actually, they torture. I can hear it scream from where I sit sometimes to come to the conclusion that their counsel was right in what they did, even though they know that they were dead wrong. And so those are the types of things, and I knew Steve's presentation would hit today, and that is individual decisions that we make do mean something. They build a reputation for us, and they actually state who we are. And over the years, those experiences that we have accumulate, and so the developer who is a 10 will always be a 10, and whenever he comes into the city, he's treated like a 10. The developer who's a 3, we try to figure out ways of keeping him out of the city because of the fact that we know he's going to be a 3 on the next project as well. And as we build these reputations, I think it's significant to understand that the small decisions we make on a day-to-day basis, based on the things that Steve has talked about, become extremely important.
And I want to end with a personal, I had another story I wanted to tell about money, but only that, you'll have to decide what your price is. Hopefully it's nothing. Anyway, again, I was visiting here over the Christmas holidays when I was in grad school in Oklahoma. I worked for Oklahoma City, and I ran a red light. I misjudged it, and it was red when I went through it, and I got pulled over. And when I handed in my driver's license, I also handed in my Oklahoma City Municipal Councilor ID, and a decision I regret to this day. And he said to me, "Why did you hand me this?" And I said, "I'm hoping that it tells you that I try to fly right most of the time." That's basically what I said. To this day, I wish he would have given me a ticket. He only gave me a warning, and I thought. And as I drove away from that, I had such a sick feeling in my stomach. And I thought, that was stupid. And so this may come as a surprise to you, but since then I have been pulled over a couple of dozen times. Anyway, and I have never indicated who I was. In fact, I got pulled over by one of our officers who was brand new. And he had transposed a couple numbers on the plate. He came up to me and he says, first he says, "Do I recognize you?" I said, no. And he says, these license plates are supposed to be on a whatever, Ford, and I was driving an Oldsmobile or whatever. They used to make Oldsmobiles. Anyway, then he made the mistake, instead of just running it again on his MDT, he called it into dispatch. And of course, dispatch runs it right, and they see that he's got me pulled over. Anyway, and then another time I got a ticket in Weber County, and it was for passing, it was for using on the interstate, the emergency stop lane, you can't drive in it. Shock, that's the law. But on Highway 89, it's not a limited access freeway, and traffic was backed up, and I was turning right, and so I used the right side of the road. I didn't pass any cars, because passing on the right, you're the disfavored driver. Anyway, then they were waiting for me. They gave me a ticket, and I said to my wife, I'm just going to call and see if I can do traffic school or whatever. And she got mad at me. She said, if it's not a right ticket, it's not a right ticket. So then I'm embarrassed because I got to go to Weber County and meet with one of the attorneys. Well, fortunately, it was a new attorney. He looks at me and says, do I know you? No, you don't know me. They showed him the code section, and he says, yeah, you're right. We need to dismiss the ticket. And on the way out, he says, now I know who you are. But anyway, but that experience, I don't know how many years ago, 30 plus years ago, has stayed with me and born, is my ethics, are my values tied to that simple traffic ticket? Seriously, who are you?
Since that time, we've told our police officers, you always give Steve a ticket. And we've told our prosecutors that you never give him a break.
We had an example as a judge. He got pulled over for his registration had expired, and the officer says, just get taken care of, judge. And the judge said, no. What is your standard? How many days over expired do you write a ticket? If so, you write me a ticket. And anyway,
good. So I want to introduce something else to you that we're discussing with PRC this year, and that is we have a group, and it was a recommendation from the PRC to the group as a whole, but we are going to try this without legislation. So it's like walking on a tightrope without a net. So we're going to try it without legislation, and what we're going to try to do is to establish groups of experts in the area of land use. You remember they talked about Washington, the state of Washington, and the fact that there was a court that reviewed land use decisions. Don't want to go that far. I don't think we're there in the state of Utah yet, but you know, the concept of having an arbiter who understands land use is a very, very good concept. And so what we've tried to put together, and what we will try to put together this next year through the Ombudsman's Office, is something under or less than an actual opinion letter, but would be a decision made by maybe three to six individuals who would be experts in land use. And I'm looking at them right now. You're out there. You can participate. You've been involved in land use, many of you, and so with those groups, the League will submit names, PRC will submit names, the Ombudsman, if you have the toughest thing for developers is to hurry and try and get the project built, because every day is money, and the difficulty with sometimes Ombudsman's opinions is that they're ways out. They try to do them as quickly as they can. So this will provide faster means for coming to a decision on a land use issue that is not binding, but will give you an idea of whether the city's off base or whether the developer's off base in the imposition of statutory provisions. So we're going to try that this next year. I think that was a good probably conclusion to an ethics, to say we're going to make sure that we have some type of policing on all of you as a result of land use. I've often wondered why we have a set of rules called ethics rules, because if we all practice the things that Steve talked about, we probably wouldn't need a set of ethics rules. But we do make up a set of ethics rules, and we tighten them up every year, the same way we tighten up legislation to try and compensate for those who don't obey the rules. But I think this is a good idea. I think it's non-binding, and I think it will be a very good idea. If there are any questions, we'd be glad to answer them, because I think we're at the end of our time. Are we over time? Yes, thank you. Craig's tapping his watch. So thank you very much. Yeah.